Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you, Father. Says, praise the Lord. I will extol the Lord with all my heart. In the council of the upright and in the assembly, great are the words of the Lord. They are pondered by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic are his deeds, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. He provides food for those who fear him. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works, giving them the lands of other nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are steadfast forever and ever. Done in faithfulness and uprightness, he provides redemption for all his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belong eternal praise. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Isn't this a wonderful song? To God all the glory and honor. Amen. Amen. And welcome, brothers and sisters, to the house of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. for wisdom. Be unto him. He's most worthy of praise. He's most worthy of our worship and our adoration this morning. Unto Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone be all praise in the church. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the head of the church, which is your body, the fullness of you. We thank you, Lord God, that the whole earth shall be filled with the knowledge and the glory of God. We thank you, Lord God, for the precious promises that we receive in your word, O God. We thank you, Lord God, that this morning, O Lord, the scriptures are alive, O Father God. We thank you that day by day, day by day, day by day, we see, O Lord God, the coming to pass of the scriptures, O God. We thank you, O Lord God, that there shall be a fulfillment of all things that you have given unto us and that you have told us, your word, O God. Almighty Father, we thank you this morning. We give you praise, glory, and honor this morning. In the name of Jesus. I thank you this morning, O God, that your word will flow freely this morning. Uninterrupted, O Lord God, for it is attending the movement of strategy. In the name of Jesus. O Lord God, we thank you this morning that the people of God will be liberated by the word of God. Father God, we pray this morning for hearts that will be open and ready to receive your precious word. In the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you this morning. We have not come into this place, nor have we joined this telecast this morning, O God, to hear the word of a man. But we have, O Lord God, by divine appointment, we have made it here. We have tuned in now to receive, O Lord God, with meekness.
He is our life.
Amen.
He is our life.
Amen.
He is our life.
The Lord reminded me that he's not yet done yet.
Amen.
He's not yet done yet.
Amen.
He's working on your miracle.
Yes.
Somebody just say he's working on my miracle. When I say he's working on your miracle, I don't mean that he still has to do it. It's done already.
Amen.
You understand? It's on its way. That is what I mean. It's on its way. 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 I'm reminded of Daniel. The Bible says when Daniel prayed, then the Bible says for 21 days, Daniel was fasting. God led him to fast for 21 days. And when the angel came to Daniel, I love the salutation. Daniel, a mighty man of valor. He says, from the very first day the prayer was made, I was sent. That means when you pray now, God's got his angels moving on your behalf. Think some of you, the stuff that you prayed about last year, your angels are on the way, on the way, on the way, on the way, they're on the way, they're on the way. Hallelujah. You may have forgotten what you prayed about, but God hasn't forgotten. It's still on his calendar. It's still on his agenda. And God is going to come through for you. Say amen to that. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Well, good morning once again. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I bring greetings from Dr. Singh and Dr. Baker Singh and the family of FCI Ringa Durban. Extend the greetings. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. I'm sure as they're watching now, they can hear the greetings of them back too. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Welcome in the presence of the Lord. This morning, before I go into the Word of God, I'd first like to just invite our visitors. If there's anybody visiting us for the first time, or we should visit this morning, would you just raise your hand? We just love to welcome you. Amen. Just raise your hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you. Welcome, family. Welcome. The baby. Welcome. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome. And baby Kelsey, welcome. Our first baby dedication after lockdown was baby Kelsey. Praise God. Welcome, Kelsey. Praise God. Hallelujah. I must say, I'm very inspired that as parents, you took it that step, you dedicated your child very often, very often. And this is the sadness of it all. You get people in the church, so-called Christians, you see them in church three times in their lifetime. When they hatch, when they match, and when they dispatch. Okay. You see them three times, hatch, match, and dispatch. In other words, when they hatch, when they are born, when they match, when they get married, and dispatching is when, you know, they come to church with us. They get chauffeured. But praise God, I admire your dedication and your commitment. May the Lord be extremely gracious towards you. May He honor you as you honor Him. Bring your children to the house of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Welcome to everybody as well. And before I go into the Word of God, I would like to this morning call upon Sister Nomsa Zulu, and she's going to share a testimony this morning. Psalms last week. So she was diagnosed with diabetes.
that it is why she was 8 years old. Now she's 13 years. So on Monday, when I went to work, around about 9, I received a call from the school saying she's not well. So I had to knock off and fetch her. So I fetched her on Monday, then we went home, we gave her her medication, then she was well after that. Then I said to him, no, we mustn't go to school on Tuesday, we'll go on Wednesday. So she went on Wednesday, then on Thursday at 1 p.m., we received a call again saying she's not well. And I said, oh, anyway, it's 1 p.m. and the meeting was at 2 p.m. So I just phoned the transport driver to fetch me, So immediately after 2, the transport driver phoned me saying, she's not well. Let's meet on the way. So I met the transport driver on the way. Like I was sitting in the car because I was expecting that this would come from the car to my car, from her transport. Then I'm seeing the driver coming out of her office seat and taking her on his arms. He was like, no, there's something wrong now. Then when she was like, she dropped her in my car in the office seat. She wasn't even well in his mental state because she was saying the things that I didn't understand by then. Then all of a sudden she's quiet. Then I said, no, this person is going now. I just called her. No, say, Paul, come back to life. You must live and not die and declare the goodness of the Lord. Yeah. And like she was like fading. While she was fading, I tried to call her mom, she doesn't pick up. I called Noctula, that's my friend, which some of you, then you know it. She didn't pick up. I called another family who normally we pray with. They don't pick up, they don't want this. Like I'm wasting time while I'm busy calling other people. Let me continue to pray. And while I'm in the car, I still continue to pray until I got home. So I thought it would be like Monday. When she got her medication, then she would be well. She was worse. We called the pastor, I'll just read where, because it would be long if I don't read it, so that I can cut the my testimony short. So what actually I'm saying, we must believe God no matter what. Because we are in a fight. And it's a good fight of faith. So how do we fight? This fight is just by taking God at his word. As I've already said, that Lucy confessed she was very sick to the point of death. I don't know whether she was in coma or dead, as she was not responding. And I called her back to life, saying, Lucy, come back to life. You shall not die, but live and declare the goodness of the Lord. Then I called Pastor Sharon for prayer, who then prayed with Pastor Ricardo. Then after that, Unati, her brother, and my brother, we rushed her to the hospital. And we continued praying in the car, and also same as pastors, they were also praying. And she was admitted in ICU on Thursday. Then on Friday, she was better. Actually, when they admitted her in ICU, they discovered that she has ketones. The medical staff can tell you how dangerous are ketones. And the results of the ketones, it's either you go for a coma or you die. Then on Friday, she was better. Or the ketones on Thursday, she tested 3+. Then on Friday, when I went to visit her, they say it's only 1, that's it. Then yesterday, they were cleared. And I believe God that she will discharge soon. Amen. And above all, she is healed from all sickness. I'd like to thank Pastor Sharon and Ricardo for standing with us. We know we want Jesus 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, 300,000, and so forth. I can't stop thinking of the goodness of the Lord. Our God is good. He's so amazing. He is gracious and compassionate.
God who is mindful of us. The God who never forsakes us. The God who never leaves us. The God who remains true. For He is true. Amen. I love what the Bible says. It says that when God made the promises unto Abraham, He swore by nobody and nothing else greater, but swore by Himself. Because there's nobody and nothing that is greater than the God we serve. God doesn't need an alibi. God doesn't need an alibi. It's God Himself. It's good in Himself. Amen. Praise God. Come on, give the Lord praise. Thank you. Lift up your hands. I just feel it in my spirit. Father, we want to thank you for those people's life. We want to thank you, O God, that that same spirit which raised Christ Jesus from the dead, O Lord God, abides in her. And that same spirit, O Lord God, which raised Christ from the dead, right now is quickening her mortal body for your glory. We thank you this morning that she will live to declare the works of the Lord, to declare the goodness of the Lord. She shall be a testimony, O Lord, unto many of the grace of God and the love of God in Christ Jesus. So we give you thanks, we give you praise, glory, honor, and worship. We thank you for answered praise. In your blessed name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. That we give thanks. It is important that we give thanks. And I think it's fitting this morning as I will share with you the word of God this morning from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 28. I would like to share with you along the lines of the value of remembering. There's great value in remembering. Tell your neighbor, you better be a rememberer. You better be a rememberer. There's great value in remembering. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, you know, we can look at it this way. When a child is of age, any child grows up in a home, and the child is conditioned in that home. There's certain things that that child is brought up with, and its morals and values and standards, and it's a type of behavior. You could call it a culture if you like. The child is tortured. The child is nurtured. When that child comes of age and the child is old enough to move out of the house, probably you find that either the child moves on to go and study at tertiary level, or the child perhaps goes to start work, or whatever it is, or the child is about to get married. But when a child leaves, there's always this that's on the lips of every parent. No matter who you are, no matter where you are, you've probably heard these words from your parents to you. And the words are as such: remember what I taught you. Not so. Those words, you can take them lightly, but it's a lasting imprint that those words make upon your heart. Remember what I taught you. Because remember this, that child now has to go out on their own. And now that child, there will be things the child will face. They'll face the reality of life. Come on, somebody. How many of you know that when you are below 12 years old, mom and dad know everything? And then from 12 to 16, They think they know everything. Then from 17 to 24, they know nothing. I know everything. And when you really face life at 25 plus, mom and dad knew what they were talking about. So that's the cycle and the pattern of life. So when a child has to face the reality of life, the child has to bring to remembrance the things that they were taught. You may find that probably the child maybe gets married and there are issues that happen in the marriage. The first thing the child does is what? They remember they got a house, they remember they got a mother, they remember they got a father, and then they start picking up phones. Well, they shouldn't be picking up phones, but remember! Come on, somebody. I was speaking to some people this morning. Quit picking up the phone. Quit picking up the phone. Running home to mommy and daddy. Had you listened to mommy and daddy in the first place, you wouldn't be where you are. You made your bed, sleep in it. Oh, Jesus, you need to get me squirt high. That's the truth of God's word. Listen, you can, you know, commit a hijack or robbery or murder. You go to jail, you still get off for good behavior. But when you get married, it's for life.
Amen.
I said, when you get married, when you come, you stand at the altar, it's for life.
Amen.
It's not until things are no more rosy and then I must call mommy and I must call daddy and I must go back. No. The Bible says you will leave and cleave. You will leave your mom and dad and you cleave to your spouse. You don't leave your spouse and go cleave to your parents. It doesn't work that way. Come on, somebody. But you remember, when you start work, and there's challenges at work, and now all of a sudden, you can't handle the heat, and now you want to give up, now you want to resign, or you want to leave work. No, you stay there. If you think back, how many sacrifices, think of the sacrifices your parents made for you. They never quit work because of you. That's why you are where you are, because of those sacrifices that they made. Because of the things that they had to endure. They remembered who they had. They remembered they had a responsibility to you. They remembered that their parents too instilled values in them. So you too ought to remember. Speaking to some of you youngsters that are studying at varsity, you understand that maybe it's become so hard, but don't give up. Remember why you started in the first place. Because very often you can give up because of the challenges of life. Then you end up forgetting everything. And all you focus on is this problem or this issue. No, remember why you started. Remember the sacrifices that were made to send you to school so that you could be educated. Remember that. Some of the matrics you went next year to varsity. Remember. That's the word that I want to give to you this morning is remember. The word remember, the dictionary defines the word remember as to recollect accounts, events, and thoughts that have happened in one's life to recollect. It's a recollection. So you have a collection of stuff to remember. And in Deuteronomy chapter number 8, and I'm reading from verse 1. This is Moses speaking to the nation of Israel. He said, every commandment which I command you today, you must be careful to observe. You must be careful to observe. Be careful to remember. Why? That you may go in. Hallelujah. That you may live so. That you may live. Not only will you live, but you multiply. And go in. And possess the land of which the Lord spoke to your fathers. The Message translation starts that scripture as such. It says, keep and live out every commandment. Keep and live out. Brothers and sisters in Christ, it's only when His word is in you that you can live out His word. When it comes to living the word of God, it's not about head sense. The word of God will never make sense to your head. The word of God makes sense to your spirit. The word of God connects with your spirit. And it's only when that word is there, that's why, remember Jesus said, he who believes in me, and who is Jesus, he's the word. He who believes in me, he who believes in the word, from deep within his being, will flow rivers of living waters. Rivers of living waters. So life will flow. That means the word is alive, but the word needs to be alive in your spirit first. Because you cannot live out something that's not there. It's the same with love. If you can't love yourself, how can you ever love others? It's the same with forgiveness. If you can't forgive yourself, how can you forgive others? You can only give what you have. Hallelujah. In John's Gospel, chapter number 8, Jesus speaking with the Jews of his day, all the religious leaders who were arguing, and they said they had Abraham as their father. And he says, if Abraham was your father, you would do the works of Abraham. And Jesus spoke and he says, my words, the words I speak in, that I speak to you, they have no dwelling place. They cannot dwell. My words have no place in you. So you see that? You must allow the word of God first place in your life, regardless of circumstances. Regardless of what you're facing, God's word must have first and foremost place in your life. And it's when you keep it. You see, the Bible says, from deep within the heart, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. So the word of God must be in your heart, not in your head, in your heart, in your spirit. Hallelujah. Because once that word is there, then the word now will cause you to live. The word will cause you to multiply. You live. Because remember, the word is bigger than your surroundings. It's the word that brought life. Everything that you see around you came as a result of the word. So when that word is dwelling in you, you begin to speak the word. But when you speak the word, you're speaking from the spirit. You with me? Hallelujah. That's why Paul continually is telling the church, put on the new man created in Christ Jesus. Renew your mind. Allow your recreated spirit to speak. No, you see, that's how the degenerated man, the degenerate man, the fallen man, is the one who says, I speak my mind. But the regenerated man understands that I have the mind of Christ. Because that's what the Bible says, you have the mind of Christ. When you receive Christ, you got back your mind. Your mind is sound. Hallelujah. Your mind is sound. So now when you face with things in life, you speak. You speak as Christ. Oh Jesus, come on somebody. When the storms and the winds are blowing, the degenerated man will look at the storms and cry. Pastor Kim, I'm on that they are perishing. Peace be still. Oh, you have a little faith. See that? The regenerated man, the man who's born again, that born again man, that born again spirit, that spirit has the word of God living there. And it's that spirit that speaks peace. Peace. Be still. Then you find the waves and the winds obey. Because when that person speaks, it is as God Himself is speaking. That's why it's so important as believers that we study the Word of God and we dwell in the Word of God. And you can learn these things. And the devil knows that. That's why he'll hinder you from hearing the Word of God. He'll hinder you from going to church. He'll stop you because he knows. He doesn't want you to know what you are truly capable of. He doesn't want you to know what is rightfully yours in Christ. So he knows that if he can cut you off from that, he can run amok in your life. But when you understand who you are, you're able to speak to him and tell him to go. And he'll obey authority. Because when he hears you speak, he sees you speak, he sees Jesus and not you. Come on, somebody. So that word will cause you to live, will cause you to multiply. That word, listen, the word will cause you to go into the land. That's what Moses said. You go in and possess. So in other words, you go in and you dispossess nations greater than you and take possession of their land because of the word of God in you. And when God gives you a word, he gives you what he's done already. It's up to you to take that word by faith and operate in the truth of his word. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. So you go in. Truly are made of. It's When you go through those fires of life that you understand, greater is He that is in me. Then you understand what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what they discovered when they got to the other side of the fiery furnace. This God is a God who saves His people. This God is a God who delivers His people. This God is a consuming fire, so there's no fire that the enemy can ever put you in that's greater than Him, because He is a consuming fire. He's the fire of fires. When Moses went and he stood before Pharaoh, he threw down his rod and he became a serpent. The magicians of Egypt did the same. They threw down their rods and they became serpents.
Your body, healing to your spirit, healing to your marriage, healing to your family.
teacher you can have in this life of faith is God Himself. That's why those who walk with Jesus, they call Him teacher. That He might teach you that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. How sad it is, how many folk, you go into a restaurant, the first cockroach you see, or the first thread of hair you see on your plate, you refuse to eat it, you reject it, and you send it back. If you eat in a place and you discover that a place is filthy, you stop going there and you stop eating there. We are so picky and choosy about what we naturally eat, but when it comes to the food of the Spirit, we put up with any garbage. As long as it sounds good enough and I think it, you know, it kind of connects with me, it's okay. But the minute it inflicts a bit of pain in my spirit and I can't handle the truth, I don't want to hear it, I cut off. bread of life. Jesus. The most important thing that Jesus said was at the Lord's table. And twice he said to his disciples, and twice he said it to the Apostle Paul, do this in remembrance of me. Remember, I brought you out. Remember, I brought you out to bring you into something better. And those are the words that God echoed to Israel. It's to remember. Remember. Remember how he brought them out of Egypt. Remember how he led them through the wilderness with our scorching heat, fiery serpents. Remember how he fed them with manna that they didn't know about. Remember how he caused the waters to flow from the flinty rock. Remember.
Are you available to pray when he wakes you up?
So you allow yourself to be isolated, and guess what? The colder your heart becomes. Because that cold will die out.
Yep.
That's what happens. The fire and the zeal and the desire for God dwindles and diminishes. And then you think it's okay. No, the church from home. No, the Bible says do not neglect the gathering of the saints. Do not neglect the gathering of the saints. You heard the testimony of Sister Lopes up this morning. One will put 1,000 to flight, two will put 10,000 to flight. So you're sitting there in your home, keep your 100,000 demons in your home. Because when two or more are gathered in my name,
Christians.
when that breath is gone, when you breathe your last, have you made heaven your home? The word of God was given to us, yes, to be able to fight in this life, but more importantly, to teach us the ways of God so that we can make heaven our eternal home. That's why God gave us His will. If we cannot live this word here, in heaven, this word is living there. You can't live it here. What makes you think you're going to live it there? Live on the promises of God. Live on His word. Verse 11, the Bible says, beware that you do not forget the Lord your God. Beware, do not forget. Where do you see that sign? By someone's house, beware. Danger. Paso. That you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping His commandments, His judgments, and His statutes, which I command you today. Lest when, watch it, when you have eaten and are full, and have built beautiful houses and dwell in them, and when your herds and your flocks multiply, and your silver and your gold are multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied, when your heart is lifted up and you forget the Lord your God. People who are full are very often forgetters. They forget when, you know, you're full now. You were once unemployed, now you're employed. But when you were unemployed, you stood in that line for that interview. And you went and you sat in that interview, and they asked you, why should we choose you? Why are you the best candidate? Oh, because I'm loyal. You lie. People who cannot remember are very most often disloyal people. There's no loyalty there because you get the job. Now you're no more unemployed. Now you're employed. After 6 pay slips, you now think you own the place. You are the kind of boss meant to get with. But in the interview, you say otherwise. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You forgot what it was like to be unemployed. So now, instead of doing 100%, giving your boss 100% of your time, of your work, of your labor, and of your skill, you give them 50% because your heart is not good. And then when you get retrenched or when you get fired, and you're back on the unemployment list, now you remember, oh. And then you're going to blame the devil. No, it was not the devil, it's your own stupidity that got you. You forget what it was like when you had nobody at your side. And the person that God has lent to you, you treat any old how. Then when the person's no more there, now you're going to cry over what you had. Remember. Remember, tell somebody, remember. Since when your heart is lifted up and you forget, people who are full of pride very often forget. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. When your heart is lifted up and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, you forget how God took you out of bondage. Who led you through the great and terrible wilderness in which were fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty land where there was no water. You forget how God led you. You see, God didn't just take you out of bondage, but He was there with you, leading you. His presence is what you speak somebody this morning. You could be faced with a difficult situation. You could be faced with impossibility. I don't care how many people have told you that it is impossible, or how many people told you that it cannot be done. What the Word of God says, He says, who brought water for you. It means God, listen, let them say what they want to, but because of you, you are the apple of His eye, God will bring the water just for you. Even if you were the last person on God's green earth, Christ would still have come to die for you, just for you. In the wilderness of manna, which your fathers did not know, that He might humble you and that He might test you to do you good in the end. The lessons that God teaches are always for your good. All things work together for good to those who love God, who are called according to His plan. The power to get wealth, that He may establish His power. This is a covenant. for a spouse, a home, whatever it is, he will pray to God. And when God comes through, how sad it is that they become full of themselves and so empty of God. The things take the place of God. It's true. He says, you shall surely perish. As the nations which the Lord destroys before you, so you shall perish, because you would not be obedient to the voice of the Lord your God. He says, here, O Israel, you are to cross over the Jordan today. Go in to dispossess nations greater and mightier than yourself. Cities great and fortified up to heaven, a people great and tall, the descendants of the other king, whom you know and of whom you heard and said, who can stand before the descendants of Anak? Therefore understand today that the Lord your God is he who goes over before you as a consuming fire. He will destroy them and bring them down before you. So you shall drive them out and destroy them quickly, as the Lord has said to you. The word of the Lord. Remember, let me give you a few pointers of people who remember and people who forget. Number one, remembrance keeps you humble. Remember, I think 2 weeks ago I preached on humility. How humility brings you to a place where you flow in the miraculous. Remembrance keeps you humble. You see, when you're someone who remembers, it doesn't matter how you prosper in life, you always remember your roots. You remember where you come from. You remember where you come from. You do not become someone who walks with your nose in the sky. It's prideful. There's only one person in the clouds, and he's God. If your nose is there, be careful you don't get a jab. Remembrance keeps you humble. Number two, remembrance causes you to grow in love and compassion. If you can remember how God loved and how compassionate God was with you and how patient God was with you, you'll be able to love others and be compassionate to others, because you can see yourself in others. You see how you once were. Remember. Remembrance causes you to be grateful, thankful, and appreciative. That's what remembrance does. It causes you to be grateful. And then you are thankful. You can appreciate everything that God does. Hallelujah. Remembrance causes you to see and to value how much love, grace, and mercy the Lord has bestowed upon you. When you become a person that remembers, you'll be able to see how much grace God has given you. You'll be able to see how much love God has for you. You'll be able to see that. And you'll be able to appreciate that. Forgetfulness, on the other hand, people who forget are often the most deadly. Most deadly person is someone who's a forgetter. Hallelujah. Praise God, they are most deadly, people who forget. Because they become so full of themselves. They fail to see God anymore in the picture. People who forget are often prideful, arrogant, and very haughty. Hallelujah. We just read in the scriptures when Moses said, "Lest your heart be lifted up." The minute you start, you become forgetful of what God has done, forgetful of His word, forgetful. mindful of his statutes. The fire, very easily the fire comes in, arrogance comes in, haughtiness comes in. The third point is people who are forgetful are often disloyal, unfaithful, and untrustworthy. Hallelujah. Do not be forgetful. Do not forget the Lord your God. Hallelujah. Tell somebody, I will not forget. You forget. You forget. People forget. It's like somebody, they get promoted. Maybe you get promoted to work, you get promoted to a manager. You forget what it was like when you were there at the bottom. And you finally become so disloyal. Start bending the rules, breaking all the rules, do your own thing. Those who forget God will be forgotten of him. That's what the Bible says. Those who forget the Lord. You forget God. Imagine if God forgets your children. There's one land of forgetfulness the Bible speaks about. That's the land of the dead and the grave. That's the land of forgetfulness. Those people are forgotten. I mean, if you remember the Lord in all your ways. Now I'm trying to think of Smith's Eagles. When he went to be with the Lord, I'm sure it was said, this man loved the Lord. That today, many years later, people are still to remember Smith's Eagles. May it be said of you, this man, this woman, loved the Lord. I'm going to stand on the word of God. I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait for that special man. I'm waiting for that special person. I'm waiting for that one. Because when I receive that one, it will be one from God. One that will value me and treasure me. Not take me as someone cheap. Are you getting what I'm getting at, people of God? It doesn't mean because the whole world is doing it, we're going to do it too. No. We must not be. Listen, Jesus is the head of the church. When you read the book of Revelation, you find that he knows the church. And he even spoke to the compromising church too. We must not be a church that will compromise the gospel. When you compromise, is when you say, okay, I want the word of God to fit in with what I think or my agenda. No. You never see the power of God unless you fit in with his plan, unless you fit in with his word. When you open his word and you open your heart and you say, Lord, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. You say, Lord, I'm availing myself to hear your word. Lord, speak to me. Speak to me, Lord. That is where God shows you where you fit in. And where you can fit in with his word. That's where the power is. You will never fit in with the world. The world rejected Jesus. They will reject you. If they said Jesus was demon possessed, will they not say that of you? He forewarned us. He told us. You are a peculiar people. Holy nation. Chosen generation. Chosen of God. For his glory. You may not be man's choice, but you are God's choice. Those of you, when you go to a place of work tomorrow, when you go to your business tomorrow, I want you to ponder on this word. I am God's truth. God chose you to be there where you are. He appointed you to be there. You are there by divine design. You are there by divine plan. You are there by divine assignment. And lay over until God says it is over. Praise God. May you be a remembrance of the Lord your God. Remember him in all your ways. When you wake up in the morning, remember it's not your own breath that you are breathing. It's his breath. He can require it of you at any time. Remember, wherever you go, whatever you touch, whatever you have, it belongs to you.
Yeah.
It's all yours. See, can you remember that? The house you're living in, remember, it's not yours, it's his. The clothes you wear, it's not yours, it's his. Everything you have, it's his. The question is, am I honoring him with it? That night, when you close your eyes, remember, your dreams belong to you. But tomorrow belongs to you. We can begin to think that way, live and function that way. God will bring to you on your bed at night, will bring to you ideas, will bring to you inventions, will bring to you dreams. It will change and shape not just your life, but the destiny and lives of many nations. that Joseph received the dreams from God, the blueprints of his future. Those are the blueprints that affected not just him, but affected nations. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this one thing I pray, that as you lay your head upon your pillow before you sleep at night, thank God for the glorious day that He has given you. Thank God for the wonderful destiny which awaits you. Give unto God your dreams and hopes and aspirations. And as you do that, may the Lord bring to pass every dream, every holy desire that He has birthed within your spirit. This one thing I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask Sister Alicia to come up and she's going to share the offering as she comes to encourage her and thank the Lord for her. Sister Alicia, please come.
Greetings, beloved. Amen. Let's just say to the Lord, thank you, Lord, for these hands. Today we remember what you've given us, Lord. We thank you for what you've placed in our hands thus far, Lord. And if you give us nothing more today, Father God, we will be thankful. What the Lord has given us, what the Lord has made this planet to be. So if we look around at our ecosystem and we see the animals and we see ourselves, and God was saying that God gave, like the lion, He gave the lion its roar as its defense. He gave the cheetah its speed as its defense. It gave the elephant its weight as its defense. But what has God given us, man, as our defense? And the Lord was saying, He gave us our brain, He gave us our imagination as our defense. So the Lord was trying to say that there's many things that we pray about that He doesn't do those things. It's in our hands. So the Lord was saying that He doesn't make chairs and He doesn't make tables. He only brings it halfway. So the Lord will make cheese, but you find us will be paying for chairs. So the Lord was saying is that the problem with us is we think that the Lord makes furniture, but He doesn't make furniture. So we pray and pray and say, God, can you please bless me with a chair? God, can you please bless me with a table? If you bless me with a chair, I will praise you, Lord. If you bless me with a table, I will worship you, Lord. But the Lord is saying He doesn't make chairs and He doesn't make tables, but the Lord makes trees. Amen. Amen. So when the Lord gives us an opportunity, what we need to do is imagine what that opportunity could be. Amen. So the Lord gives us trees. We need to imagine the chair. We need to imagine the table. Amen. So if the Lord gives us a child, we need to imagine what that child could be. If the Lord gives us a spouse, we need to imagine what that spouse could be. If the Lord gives us a job, we can imagine what that job can be. If the Lord gives us a car, we can imagine what that car can be. Amen. Amen. So even if we pray for a job, sometimes we keep praying and say, God, please give me a job, please give me a job. But it can be the opposite way. We ourselves can be the job. Amen. Amen. Sometimes we need to look at what God has given us in our hands, what He has already given us. Because in each and every one of us, He's given us something. He's already planted seed in us that we can make a job for ourselves. Amen. Amen. were thinking, how are we going to feed these 5,000 people? But the miracle was in the two fish and the five loaves that they already had. Amen. Amen. So in Matthew 25 verse 15, it's a scripture about the talents that the Lord gave the three servants. So he says he gave five bags of silver to one, two bags of silver to another, and one bag of silver to another. Now if we can translate this maybe to our times, we can say it as the Lord gave five bags of 1 million rand to one, he gave two bags of 1 million rand to another, and he gave one bag to another. Amen. So the one with the five bags returned with five more. The one with two bags returned with two more. But the one with the one bag just returned with the one. Amen. So the one with the one bag, he was still given a seat. Amen. He was still given 1 million rand. It was still 1 million rand. So the job that you have, it's still a job. Amen. The car you have, it's still a car. That car can be a seed. Amen. Seed you have, it's still a seed. You have seed. Amen. We all have seed. Amen. So the first thing that God said to Adam was to be fruitful. Now in order for you to be fruitful, you need to be seedful. Amen. So most of us have seed that is sleeping, that is dormant. Like the one that was given the one bag, he kept his seed sleeping. He didn't use his seed. Amen. So we have seed in us that we are keeping sleep. We are keeping sleeping. It's dormant inside of us. Amen. So if we do our best with the one bag, or we do our best with the one bag, then only will we see the million. Amen. Amen. Yeah, let's just bow our heads and do this. Father God, today we remember, oh God, what you've given us, oh God. Father God, help us to use, oh God, what you've given us, you've already placed in our hands, oh Father God. Lord, we know you have a plan for our lives, oh Father God. And if you have a plan, Almighty God, that means you've already put seed in us, oh Father God. Help us, oh Father God, to recognize that seed in us, oh God, and to use, oh Father God, what we already have, Almighty God. Father God, open our eyes, oh Father God, to see what you've already given us, Almighty God. We thank you, oh God, that you have planted something in us, oh God. We have a hope, oh Lord, that there is something in us that we can use, Almighty God, for your glory, Almighty God. Father God, we thank you, oh God, for who you are today, oh Father God. We thank you, oh God, for the blessings, oh Father God. Yes, Almighty God. Yes, oh God, you have given us opportunity.
the offering, the offering box that we entered in 7 times in our head. We can go home. Praise God. Whilst we were listening, whilst Sister Bishop was ministering, it's a powerful word. I just want to quickly, by show of hands, how many of you are able to access the internet? That was some way forward. So there's quite a few of us that can access the internet. And I just feel in my spirit, we need to do something as families. And I'll share with you details next week. God has been speaking to me while I was sitting there about, from next month, we're going to have family evenings on Fridays. But it will be a meeting where we meet over the social media platform, kind of like Zoom meetings. Because our youth, I'm very, very concerned about our youth. And we can, you know, we're not having a youth meeting, so we have online meetings. We call it family meetings. There'll be something for everybody. So I will share with you later next week. Just something God has impressed in my heart. And I believe we need to do this. Praise God. Amen. And we all just bow our heads. Lift up your hands as I release the final blessing. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your Son, our Lord and Savior, we thank you this morning for the opportunity that we have received to hear your word. And not just to hear your word, but Lord, to receive faith. I pray, O Lord, we will go this morning to our respective homes and places of work and business this week. I pray that we will, Lord God, work out that faith that we have received. I thank you, Lord God, that your hand is upon your people. I pray that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Ghost shall rest and abide with all your people, both now and forevermore. In Jesus' blessed name. Now the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. Jesus blessed me. Now we go.